200 miles from nowhere, looking for Atlantis. With James Cameron on board, it seemed anything was possible.
Pick it apart. Let's be rigorous.
Now all I have to do is find a city that most people say never existed. Too many dead ends. Must find a way to connect the dots.
That looks like a boat.
And if that's the hull of a boat, that boat's underwater.
In criminal investigations, you follow the money. In archaeology, you follow the stones.
Crazy thing is,
it's the same scene over and over and over again.
I think I'm onto something big.
All right, here we go. And action.
I've always been fascinated by the future. Can you step back a half step? But I also loved imagining past worlds and what the people were like.
Okay, move forward slowly. Look in the second window just a little bit as you go by.
When I was in high school, I was fascinated by ancient Egypt, by the Greeks, by the Romans, and Atlantis. And I think that underneath this myth, this parable, there has to be something historically that happened.
And cut. So,
great to see you. Just awesome.
That's my day job.
It's a good day job.
So, we doing this?
We're doing it.
Going after Atlantis?
I've got the boat, I've got the divers, the ROV, yeah. The team.
Oh man, I gotta be there on that ship. I've never not been on the ship.
I know you do. I know you
it's
do.
It's killing me.
So I know you're, I don't
well, want we're getting set to
pull you off and we need to strategize, yeah. So.
Hey Maria, yes. Pull lunch.
Okay, all right. Guys,
let's take lunch. Let's look at some maps.
Thank you.
Everything we know about this highly debated topic comes from the Greek philosopher Plato, who wrote some 2,400 years ago. In Plato's tale, the Atlanteans ruled an aggressive empire, stretching from the Atlantic all the way to the eastern Mediterranean. Their capital, Atlantis, was a port, a unique city, made up of three concentric rings of land and water. At its center, there was a temple to the god of water, Poseidon, where the Atlanteans sacrificed bulls. There were also incredible bridges and canals connecting the various moats, and the central wide canal that cut across the city and linked the temple with the sea. And it all came to a terrible end in a single day and night, when earthquakes and tsunamis destroyed the city, submerging it beneath water and mud. But where is it?
All right, so where are we gonna go first?
A picture of a journey.
Here's Plato, right? Athens. And he's talking about a civilization that, in his words, spanned the whole region. So it's a seagoing civilization.
And they come from somewhere over here, from
right.
The western Mediterranean.
Right. So they could be anywhere.
So what's my mission?
Investigate some new hypotheses, investigate the ones that people tend to find appealing, pick it apart. Let's be rigorous.
I'm looking for the signs of a common civilization that dominated the Mediterranean all the way to the Atlantic. And maybe this quest will lead to the legendary mother city, Atlantis.
It's quite a journey.
Well, you're gonna spend a lot of time on boats.
you're the boat.
Look,
I get seasick.
You could fly, but I think if you go on a boat, you'll think the way they thought back then. And the distances will mean something to you, and you'll understand what it's like to be part of a trading culture.
First off?
Well, look, I'm very partial to the Minoans, as you know. The Minoans were definitely a seagoing civilization, one of the peak civilizations of its day on Crete and on Thera, 1,100 years before Plato. You've got a city that disappeared overnight.
Santorini.
Yeah, Santorini, absolutely. And
Why don't we get Charlie into this? You know, I mean, he wrote the book on Earthing Atlantis.
Charlie.
Get Charlie. Yeah.
So a few days later, and with the help of a few seasickness pills, I set sail along the eastern Mediterranean for the Greek island of Santorini. Years ago, this island looked much different than today. It had a round shape with an opening leading into the sea, very similar to Plato's description of Atlantis. At that time, Santorini was inhabited by the great Minoan civilization. But everything changed in 1550 BC when the volcano in the center of the island erupted with devastating force. So is Plato describing Santorini when he writes of Atlantis? To answer this, I meet with author Charles Pellegrino.
Nah, this probably happened post-eruption.
Using drones, Pellegrino's conducting a survey of ash layers in the mouth of the volcano in which he's sailing.
Can we come in closer to the original grand layer?
Recreating the events that led to the volcano's collapse.
Behind is one of the largest volcanic calderas in the world. What existed on this island before the eruption was a mountain that was up to about a mile high. It's all gone. In the experience of human history, this would have been the largest volcanic explosion. We're talking about a force that would add up to more than a million atomic bombs detonating right behind me.
The eruption went on for days. A massive rock, almost equivalent to Mount Everest, was blown into the atmosphere. The sky was darkened for days, and vast areas of the planet experienced winter, which lasted two whole years. The eruption and earthquakes that accompanied it created a mega tsunami, which reached a height of 800 feet and devastated the coasts of Crete, Egypt, and Turkey. At the north coast of Crete, the tsunami destroyed Minoan coastal towns and obliterated their massive fleet. The cloud of ash that spread from the explosion was so hot that people who stood on the shores of Crete disintegrated as the cloud hit them. Egyptian writings from that time describe a huge shockwave that destroyed houses, temples, and parts of the pyramids.
This event was so huge that there is no way that the civilizations of the time, especially in the Mediterranean, would have failed to notice it and mention it in their oral and written history.
So was the eruption of Santorini the cataclysmic event in Plato's story? Are the Minoans the long-lost Atlanteans? I traveled with Charlie to the only Minoan archaeological site still standing on the island, the Minoan city of Akrotiri. It seems to match Plato's description of a very advanced Bronze Age civilization.
I'm amazed that we're walking next to buildings that are three-story high and what 3,600 years old?
Yes.
The streets are not that narrow. You've got openness, open windows. I can see people's homes. They're more or less the same. So it's an egalitarian society.
These buildings are built with a certain degree of earthquake resistance in mind. In fact, you can see...
Wait a minute. You're saying that these people are building earthquake-resistant buildings?
Very similar to some of the designs that were developing in Japan and in the United States
today
during the 20th century.
Oh my God.
As amazing as these multi-story buildings are, is what's underneath them.
What do you mean?
Toilets, the plumbing that runs through these buildings is of a sort that we didn't start seeing again briefly during the Roman period, but in our own time, not till 200-300 years ago. If, for example, at the time of the American Revolution in Philadelphia, even at the palace in Paris, these toilets were the stairwells and the streets themselves. You could smell Paris or Philadelphia from 2 miles away.
And here, 3,600 years ago, these people have amazing architecture, high technology, flush toilets 3,600 years ago. We have aqueducts, hygiene, open society, egalitarian, and it's all destroyed overnight.
Yes.
Is this Atlantis?
I would say to a 99% probability that this is a part of what Plato was writing about in his story of Atlantis.
So the Minoans were a highly advanced civilization that vanished due to a natural disaster. But is this enough to say that they were the Atlanteans? I'm not sure. So I check in with the boss.
Sivka, hey, so why are you calling me? You missed me already, or did something go wrong?
Nothing went wrong, no boat sinking. I did spend some time with Charlie on Santorini, and I wanted to report back because, you know, in many ways it's very convincing. It's a high technology, it was destroyed pretty much overnight, but Plato says they came from the west and they were aggressive, and the Minoans were in the east and they were actually peaceful. And the other thing that really bothers me, even though I think that Santorini is part of the story, Plato never describes a volcanic eruption. It's more like he's describing tsunamis and earthquake and sinking and mud.
This gets to the kind of the fundamental question of our quest here, which is there really one place? Because you know how I feel about this. I feel it's a science fiction story. I feel that it's a parable. It's a moral and ethical parable, and he's drawing from different things in there. Collective record. He's piecing it together. You know, as a science fiction writer, you call it world building.
I differ. I don't question that Plato wanted to use it for some purpose, but I do believe that he's not just cobbling different pieces. He talks about a civilization, and there must be a point of origin. I do believe there's an Atlantis out there somewhere.
All right, well, look, let's go find it.
There's Malta out there, there's Sardinia. I want to keep going west.
Yeah, so go west, young man.
I now sail west from Santorini to the next prime candidate for Atlantis, the island of Malta. Like many others, Peter, our Maltese boat captain, believes that his homeland is Atlantis. He shares his theory with my team.
We're investigating possibility that Malta is Atlantis. Now, that's only possible if Malta was a lot bigger.
Well, Malta was definitely much larger in the not so distant past. If we take this table as an example, if we took Malta and put Malta there, and we extended Malta by bringing up that flap on that table, it gives you an idea of how large this land may have been.
What's the evidence?
If you look around the Maltese Islands, there are areas where you can actually see the bottom. You've got a ridge here across, which is really shallow, with depths of as little as 9 meters.
In your mind, there's no question that this shallow area was once above water.
Definitely. Something cataclysmic must have happened in the past.
Suddenly.
Incredible. I gotta take a picture for my kids. Ah! This is magical. They're leading us to Atlantis.
We dock in Gozo, one of the 5 islands that make up Malta. Right away, Peter takes me to the cliffs. He wants to show me more evidence that Malta was once a much bigger island. He starts with mysterious tracks called cart ruts that crisscross the entire island.
These are very impressive. Tell me about what we're looking at here.
Well, as you can see, these are clearly man-made ruts, which were hewn out of the rocks. They put large stones, round stones, spherical stones, in the ruts.
Like right here?
That's right. Then they would put the large boulders on top of the spheres and push, pull these huge stones to build their temples.
I gotta tell you, this is very impressive. When I heard about ruts, I thought we're dealing with some scratches in the stone. But you see the depth of that thing as you go towards the cliff. And clearly, they must have served some function. It's strong evidence that there was something there.
It's probable that there was a large civilization that lived on a larger island at the time.
6,000 years ago, the cart ruts seem to have been used to build megalithic structures.
The oldest part of this building dates to 2600 BC, which makes it one of the oldest man-made freestanding structures in the world. We think that the main function of these sites was sacred.
The advanced architecture on an island that has been partially submerged fits with Plato's description of Atlantis. I now go to what seems to be an even older structure to learn about the people who built these Stone Age temples.
It's amazing to me that they built all this without the wheel, without any metal tools, without cement.
We do have remains here and there of rounded stones, which could have been used to transport some of the megaliths.
They're living here for 1,000 years. Mm-hmm. They're building these amazing structures. What happened to them?
We know that the culture stopped suddenly in around 2500 BC.
Have you found weapons here?
No, there's no indication of any weapons at all. And there's really no indication of any violence.
The high technology and the sudden disappearance fits the story of Atlantis. But the Maltese were peaceful, and the Atlanteans were warlike. So I decide to keep heading west. According to Plato, Atlantis is buried beneath water and mud at the western end of the Mediterranean, just past the Pillars of Hercules, today's Strait of Gibraltar. And that's exactly where Professor Richard Freund has brought a team of divers and marine archaeologists in his years-long quest for Atlantis.
This is the absolute most sophisticated search for Atlantis.
Oh my God, look at this.
As I sail west from Malta, Professor Richard Freund is exploring an area just past the Strait of Gibraltar.
There's three rules to archaeology: location, location, location. If you're looking for a place that has specific coordinates, either in literature or in inscriptions, you go to that place.
After years of research, he believes that the search for Atlantis begins beneath these waters. To find the lost city, he's gathered some of the best divers and marine archaeologists in the world.
I have no doubt that there are vast areas that were once inhabited by people that are now hundreds of feet underwater.
The evidence is really what people want to hear about. They don't want to hear about the theories. They don't want to hear about just geophysics. They want to hear that there is evidence, and they want to know what that evidence is. Plato is writing in a very specific time period. So when he says that Atlantis was located at the Strait of Gibraltar, he called them the Pillars of Hercules in his time, every single mariner, every single Greek reader, every single person knew exactly where he was talking about. We're right in front of the Strait of Gibraltar, the Pillars of Hercules. You have to look right here.
In order to identify promising locations, Freund and his team deploy a special underwater radar and a highly advanced multi-beam echo sounder that produces detailed 3D images of objects on the ocean floor.
So what are we hoping to find? From my view, the smoking gun would be ancient, massive architecture. We're not going to find the Disney-esque version of Atlantis that's sunk and everything is intact and the statues are standing and the columns are standing and the walls are perfect. What we're going to find is pieces, but we're going to find lots of pieces. It's what I call the debris splatter. Debris splatter means whenever there is a destruction, the destruction is always going to leave evidence splattered over a large area. Atlantis was supposed to be a very large city. Anything that's still left from the debris is going to end up in the Atlantic, in this area.
On the command bridge, the crew monitor the screens. They're looking for anything unusual bulging from the sea floor. The process is painstaking. Sometimes hours go by without seeing anything out of the ordinary.
Okay, guys. Here we go.
Here we go.
We start showing like a mountain. Can be a road, anything. Around 4 meters of high, 56 meters wide. So probably means that there is something down there.
I can't see anything. Visibility really bad.
Slow down.
I'm following the shot line down.
Clearing up.
The divers are now more than 150 feet deep.
What's that, Edo? Can you see that?
It's a shipwreck. But it's not ancient. It's made of iron, and it's relatively modern. They keep looking around, but it's soon clear that at this site, they will not find what they're looking for. While the search continues off the coast of southern Spain, I'm nearing Sicily. Freund is right. Plato places Atlantis west of the Pillars of Hercules. And most scholars are convinced that he's talking about the Strait of Gibraltar. But some historians believe that Plato's referring to the Strait of Messina between the Italian peninsula and the island of Sicily.
We're sailing right through the Strait of Messina right now. Sunrise, it's gorgeous. And you can really see how close the two land masses really are. Italy's right over there, and right across, there's Sicily. So it's entirely conceivable that at one point these were regarded as the Pillars of Hercules. There might have been physically some pillars put up as you sailed out into the Mediterranean. So I can totally imagine that as seafaring got better, and they pushed out, the Pillars of Hercules moved from here, their original position, to Gibraltar, facing the Atlantic.
So if the Strait of Messina is the original Pillars of Hercules, can it be that Sardinia, on the other side of the strait, was once Atlantis? Years ago, one of the most impressive civilizations of ancient times thrived on Sardinia. So I'm headed to one of the 7,000 sites that this forgotten culture left on the island. I meet with American researcher Robert Eshoy, who has been studying Sardinia for decades. Eshoy believes that these spectacular ruins called Nuraghe are what's left of Atlantis.
This, Robert, is impressive to be sure.
Yes.
But is it Atlantis?
This culture here on Sardinia matches everything Plato describes about Atlantis. He talked about the culture as being a very advanced culture. We look at the architecture. This is very advanced technique.
It is amazing. I actually can't believe it. You know, we're inside a 3,500-year-old structure built with no cement, and it's still standing.
The circular aspects of the buildings, Plato said everything was round. They built pillars. He calls them pillars.
These round structures, were they for living in? Temples, what were they for?
The original story was that Poseidon, of course, which is a god, married a woman, and in order to protect her, he built a pillar.
A tower like this one.
Yeah, exactly.
But what about the rest of Plato's descriptions? Does the island of Sardinia match what we know about Atlantis? To find out, we travel to the southern end of the island.
Well, here we are at Nora. This is a very significant place on Sardinia. Plato specifically said that Atlantis was destroyed by earthquakes and flooding. Sardinia is a place that has frequent flooding, and in the ocean, just south of Sardinia, is a major fault. So here at Nora, there is evidence of destruction from earthquakes and flooding. And there are ruins both on the land, but also below the sea. So this is a very special place, and it gives strong evidence that there's a connection between Sardinia and what Plato said about the destruction of Atlantis.
Sardinia also has two other important characteristics that match Plato's descriptions. The rocks around the island have three colors, black, white, and red. And there are hot and cold springs everywhere. Robert has me wondering, are these the temples of Atlantis? He believes that they are, and he takes me to one of the most impressive, Su Nuraxi.
Wow. We're in the largest complex that they have found to date. This is a complex of five towers. You have the center tower, and then you have the four outer towers that match the compass, north, south, east, and west.
And until recently, very recently, nobody knew what's here.
Well, it was covered with mud completely. Imagine the height of this and completely buried by mud.
I can almost imagine the people coming out of these corridors. What are they like?
We have found figurines of warriors here. And you can tell by the fact that this place is so enclosed and protected, more than likely this was the upper class and the warrior class.
But if this is Atlantis, where's the fabled temple to Poseidon?
Look, right there. We have got to go there.
To our amazement, Plato provides the coordinates. To my surprise, Sardinia's geography geology and archaeology seem to match Plato's descriptions of Atlantis.
Oh my God. If ever there was an Atlantean house, this is it. I mean, this is what Plato describes. I don't know if it's Atlantis, but it's certainly architecture that matches the architecture that Plato describes in Atlantis.
Amazing.
So I decide to investigate one more aspect of the story. Plato describes a mountain in the middle of the island that stands in the center of a beautiful plain. On top of it, he says that Poseidon built the very first structure on Atlantis. Is there anything like this on Sardinia?
Okay, this is the Campidano Plain right here.
Okay. Is there a mountain?
Yeah, look, look, right there. Right there.
There's a Nuraghi.
A tower.
On top of the mountain. Santa Victoria.
Check it out.
We have got to go there.
This is crazy.
It is.
It's located in what used to be, in ancient times, the middle of the island, before the southern part was covered by the sea. We go there and discover a perfect fit with Plato.
I can't believe it. We used Plato as a treasure map. It said, you'll find a little mountain. You'll find a beautiful view, a fertile valley, a plain, ancient ruins.
Well, not only did we find ruins, but we found ruins that are more than likely the earliest, if not the very first, tower that was built.
Next to it, there's a temple dedicated to a water deity, maybe Poseidon. In ancient times, it was surrounded by a moat.
So what are we saying here? What are you saying here? This is Atlantis.
I'm saying that if you take the description given by Plato of all the different things about Atlantis, the geography, the island itself, the civilization, there is no other place on this earth that fits it better than Sardinia.
I'm beginning to think that Robert might be right.
Hey, Sipka, what's happening?
What's happening is I think I found it. I know this sounds crazy, but Sardinia, I think Sardinia is Atlantis.
Okay, let's hear the case.
You know, it fits exactly like Plato describes. The technology is amazing, and you find that circular motif everywhere in Sardinia. In the center of the island, sure enough, you have a temple to a water deity that sure looks and smells and sounds like Poseidon, and it's a warlike people.
All right, so you're ticking some boxes, but I'm not convinced that just because these buildings are round, that necessarily translates to the kind of concentric city plan. And as I understand it, that concentric city plan actually incorporated a harbor, and the Grand Nuraghi that you explored is much more inland. It's very far from the coast.
Yes, but all that very beautiful farmland today was once underwater, so I could imagine in the special effects in my mind that that it was surrounded by water, at least the Temple of Poseidon.
But in any case, the timing doesn't really add up, because the Nuraghic civilization emerged after the eruption.
You're right, that doesn't fit, because actually Santorini doesn't destroy Sardinian culture. It almost gives rise to it.
So maybe these were displaced people that were refugees.
Could it be that what we're seeing in Sardinia is a new Atlantis?
Yeah, I can imagine that. So you need to be looking for Nuraghis or similar architectural motifs in other places.
Still further west.
Keep going west.
Jim says, go west. There's only one candidate left. Past the Strait of Gibraltar, southern Spain, where there are others who think that there could have been Atlantean refugees. Author Georgios Diaz Montexano has been researching this area for years, and he's convinced that some Atlantean refugees fled inland and built shrines to memorialize their lost city. Deciphering the shrines would help Georgios prove his theory.
No se ve realmente la gente, pero sí se ven como tres barcos y como de 8 remos o 12 remos cada uno.
According to Georgios, the epic of Atlantis is recorded in a series of Stone Age petroglyphs, images inscribed in stone, telling the story of a drowned city, a legendary port, and ships that once sailed the Atlantic.
I think that we shoot here.
But see, that's going to mean the camera's going to
be up there.
To test his theory, Georgios enlists the help of engineer Ken Boydston and Professor Gregory Hayworth, experts in forensic photography and spectral imaging, bringing lost images back to life.
Yo pienso que la gente que opina que esto no es serio es simplemente porque no se lo han tomado en serio. Yo creo en la búsqueda honesta de la verdad, esté donde esté, sea cual sea, y caiga quien caiga.
Ready? Shoot.
Shooting.
I'm using the strobe as a raking light, which will bring out the shadows and the depth of the incisions in the rock.
Oh, yeah, this is a horse with a long flowing mane.
Yeah. Shoot.
Shooting.
I'm looking closely at the screen, and I like what I'm seeing. I can see the hoof much more clearly. I'm looking for signs of a horseshoe which has a lip at the end, and I see no signs of a horseshoe at all, which means it's pre-Roman.
That would be pre-Roman. Oh, here we go. Okay, yeah, there's a bunch of stuff here.
The investigators see wide moat-like circles that surround the entire scene.
I see a bunch of concentric circles, and in the middle of this, there's some roughly parallel straight lines.
Concentric, moat-like circles are exactly what Plato reports when describing Atlantis.
What's that line right above the horse?
Well, that's a long, wavy line, and actually there's a couple of them. There's one there and one, a further one up. Could they be mountains? Could they be waves? Could be water. Horse could be underwater.
Could be.
Could be.
The horse is tilted downwards. If it's underwater, that could mean it's drowning. And it seems,
shoot,
that it's not the only figure beneath the apparent line of water.
That looks like a boat. That looks like a boat up in the right-hand corner. Zoom in a bit, Ken.
This one here looks like maybe the hull.
That
could be the hull of a boat.
Yeah.
And if that's the hull of a boat, that boat's underwater.
While the team continues their work, I join Georgios in Badajoz, southern Spain. I've heard of his work, and I'm anxious to see some mysterious finds in this little-known museum.
Es importante. Guerreros toro. Los cuernos le salen de la cabeza, no de cascos.
In Plato, bulls are associated with the religion of Atlantis. These inscriptions are incredible. Warriors, chariots, and an undeciphered script known as Tartessan. Can this be the lost language of Atlantis? Georgios was saving the best for last.
Mira esto.
Oh my God.
Tres círculos concéntricos y un canal que entra. Y lo que hay en el centro, que simbólicamente puede ser el templo de Poseidón.
So this is a symbol of Atlantis.
Atlantis.
These concentric circles remind me of the architecture I saw in Sardinia. Can it be that southern Spain was the mother country, and these soldiers once stood guard at Atlantis?
What you're saying is that we have the entire story. We have Plato here, carved in stone. The concentric circles, the canal that goes right through, the temple of Poseidon right over here, the warriors, because it was a warlike society that tried to dominate the Mediterranean. You have a high technology. Chariots are a high technology. When you put all this together, you're telling me the entire story is carved in stone here. What you're saying is that we have a Bible of the Atlanteans.
Georgios now leads me to another site in the area. He thinks he's identified an Atlantean city. The cement squares are modern. The archaeology below is ancient. It's a massive Copper Age site. And strangely, it has hardly been reported to the scientific community. It looks remarkably like Plato's Atlantis.
I'm standing in Hayan, a 5,000-year-old city that was recently found. They discovered that it was 1 kilometer in diameter. 40,000 people lived here 5,000 years ago. And the architecture is remarkable. Concentric circles, canals, individual homes with a round architecture. The reason you haven't heard about it is because the developers got hold of it. They built on top of it, and even where I'm standing is soon not going to be here.
Hayan was a large city. 60,000 items were found here. By Copper Age standards, it had a huge population that lived here when Atlantis would have been at its height. I meet one of the archaeologists in charge of the site, Estela Perez.
La estructura de la ciudad que nosotros tenemos parte desde un punto cero. Desde ese punto cero se establecen una serie de círculos concéntricos con fosos y murallas asociados hasta 5. De manera circular, la ciudad va creciendo desde un punto central.
So why did the inhabitants of ancient Hayan build these concentric moats of water and land in an arid area? Georgios believes that Hayan is a sister city to Atlantis that was built with the same type of architecture in mind.
I know looking at this rubble, it may be very hard to imagine that this place should be as famous as the pyramids. So let me try to help you. Let's bring ancient Hayan back to life.
Gibraltar, Professor Freund and his divers continue their underwater search for Atlantis.
Sand, featureless sand, no obvious rocks, no, not what we wanted, man.
As they relocate to a deeper site, Freund decides to bring out the heavy guns, the ROV.
What we're gonna do is take these cameras off and put this block on.
I'm ready to go.
The ROV is lightweight, but carries a big visual punch. It can go deeper than the divers and stays longer below. It carries 4 4K cameras and transmits images to the surface. If Atlantis is in these waters, these cameras will find it.
Bridge control. Yeah, Bridge, ROV is just tracking due north. I'm only a meter off the bottom, and yet I can't really see anything. We just have to crawl along, trying to keep a constant heading.
They're deeper than the last dive, in the same area where they were looking for the debris field.
So this is why searching takes so long. It can take days, weeks, months, because you just kind of crawl along. There's not a lot of visibility until you find something.
Despite their efforts, the operators don't make any significant discovery.
The sea is very great, and you have to have patience.
Meanwhile, some 25 miles inland, Georgios takes us to what he believes is a shrine built by Atlantean refugees. Images of ships and ports at this remote location would support his idea that at some point, the real Atlantis was transformed into myth.
Creo que esta es una de las cuevas más importantes de arte rupestre que ha aparecido en toda la península ibérica y en todo el occidente. Vemos aquí portuaria, con barcos que se ven como que están entrando en un puerto, saliendo de un puerto, alejándose. 7 diseños de barcos diferentes. Y esto fue lo que me hizo a mí pensar en ese pasaje famoso de Critias, donde se narra que el puerto de la Atlántida era muy importante porque venían barcos de todas las naciones.
The spectral imaging experts cover the cave's entrance and begin their work. They use special cameras that utilize 16 different wavelengths of light invisible to the human eye so as to capture detailed images of the inscriptions.
Our job here is to try to make these very faint images as clear as possible. Perhaps discovering new symbols which are not even faintly visible to the naked eye. We're moving through the spectrum from violet up through infrared for a total of 26 shots.
I see the lines that we could barely see before. Oh, I see the boat, I see the oars.
There is some, yes.
With regular light waves visible to the human eye, the image of a boat in what appears to be a square harbor is faded and indistinct. But when photographing with special multispectral light, new details suddenly emerge.
We're seeing something very interesting. It just occurred to me what this is. This is a three-dimensional image we can see inside the boat. And these are the ribs of the keel itself that go down. The artist is sophisticated enough to actually show this in three dimensions.
New data becomes available on the other boat as well.
So what you can see from this picture is really interesting. We expected the oars, and those are oval and curved. What we didn't expect to see is that this, what we thought might be another oar, isn't. It's actually a rudder or starboard. And you can tell because look, see how it's squared off here? Yeah? It's very different from the oars, yeah. And it's coming out the back. This tells us a couple interesting things. First of all, if the rudder is over here, the boat is going in this direction, away from the harbor, which was over here.
Suddenly, they discover an image that was totally invisible to the naked eye.
When we were processing this area, something that came out that we didn't expect, and this is what we saw.
Wow.
There is, in fact, another figure. This clearly looks more like a tail, and this is like ears. We can see that this is much more like a horse and a rider who has some kind of, perhaps even a helmet on it, which has a plume on top, a feather on top, or some kind of ornament.
Next to the rider is another square that the scientists identify as a port with concentric circles. It appears as though the rider is fleeing from the port. Whoever made these drawings high in the mountains was not recording boats, ports, and fleeing horsemen that were nearby. They were recounting stories of events that occurred somewhere along the coast, far away from here.
You've got me shaken up, I can tell you that.
I'm beginning to think that Georgios is right. And this is how Atlantis was transformed into legend. We're now joined by Professor Freund. Having little luck finding an underwater debris field, he decides to take us to a unique coastal location in southern Spain, where he believes Atlantis once stood.
We're in the Doña Ana Park, one of the largest marshes in all of Europe. Hundreds of square kilometers of just marsh. But in antiquity, this was an open bay. An open bay that ships could come in all the way up to Seville. In 11 locations, we did carbon dating that goes down to 13 meters below the surface, where there's an even layer of methane, which would indicate that some catastrophic event happened suddenly that sealed all those organisms, all those living beings, into one methane layer. 4,000 BCE, 6,000 years ago, there were people living here. And then suddenly, they were not.
We drive for hours across the strange and unique landscape of Doña Ana. For hundreds of miles, it shifts between vegetation, beach, and sand. Geologically, it's clear that something extraordinary happened here. After several hours, we arrive at our destination. Professor Freund takes me to the spot he calls the archaeological smoking gun.
It doesn't look like much, Richard.
You know, sometimes big things come in small packages.
Yeah. I've seen castles and I've seen temples, and now I'm seeing a hole in the ground. Tell me why you think this is significant.
This is the last vestiges of Atlantis. It is from the time period in which Atlantis, a massive stone city, existed.
You're telling me this rock, this stone, that's the treasure?
It's not indigenous to this place. It's very, very different than any of the other stones. It's not sand, it's not mud. When I look at this and I see all the marine debris that's actually embedded into the rock surface, you can see that this is a rock that was not part of this area. And because it is so high up, I mean, we still are in the midst of the swamp. We think that a massive tsunami brought this stone in thousands of years ago and deposited it here. In criminal investigations, you follow the money. In archaeology, you follow the stones.
Professor Freund is not the first academic to come to this area. In the 1920s, two legendary archaeologists, Bonsor and Schulten, claimed that Doña Ana was once home to another lost city, Tartessos. Like Atlantis, Tartessos was a harbor city located beyond the Pillars of Hercules, famous for its metals and ships. It too mysteriously disappeared from history. Could it be that what Plato called Atlantis, the Atlanteans called Tartessos? Georgios presents us with a rare document, an ancient Egyptian map.
Ahora quiero mostrarte algo más. Esto es uno de los más antiguos mapas de Ptolomeo.
This is a map by Ptolemy.
Exacto. Una copia bizantina del mapa de Ptolomeo del siglo II.
So it's a Byzantine copy of a second century map, 1800 years old?
Correcto.
This map provides us with an ancient perspective on the Mediterranean, Strait of Gibraltar, the Atlantic, and the coast of southern Spain.
How did you find this map?
Se conserva en el British Museum.
Why are you showing us this?
Mira aquí.
Tartessos.
Tartessos.
But look, not only does it say Tartessos, but it places Tartessos in a very specific place, and it actually has an illumination, an illustration of what the city looked like and how it's facing the water.
Un símbolo de ciudad fortificada en el mismo sitio donde estamos. Exactamente. Exactamente aquí.
Right here where we are. I mean, that's...
This is crazy. Has anybody noticed this before?
Nadie. Solo la mía.
It's right there.
Yeah.
It's been hiding in plain sight.
Yeah.
We can go right there, look beneath the water.
Now that we've identified a new target area to dive, will we find the lost city at last?
Oh, oh, this is something.
With our new coordinates in hand.
How's it going, guys?
On the Atlantic Explorer, just off the coast of Doña Ana, we're looking for evidence of a debris field attesting to the destruction of Atlantis.
I'm hoping
we're in the right place.
We're in the right place.
Today, the visibility is very good. but there seems to be nothing down there. Time after time, the divers come back empty.
No fish, no weed, not even a beer can. I mean, it's just barren.
The day is nearing its end. After spending hours underwater, the divers are exhausted. They decide to pack up their gear.
I think we need to increase the area where we are searching. And I hope tomorrow is going to be a better day.
Ever the optimist, Professor Freund doesn't get discouraged.
So today was not a good day, but that doesn't mean that tomorrow it won't be a major discovery.
As the ship steers back to port, something peculiar pops up on the screens. It looks circular and man-made. We have a hard choice to make. Even though the divers are very experienced, Professor Freund is concerned that they're too tired to make another descent. But Eduardo and his diving team are worried that by tomorrow, the weather won't cooperate. They decide to go for it.
Those giant discs.
These discs must be man-made, there's no question about it.
Ancient for sure, but what are they?
I've no idea, mate.
Professor Freund believes that these circular discs are part of the debris field that he's been looking for. He thinks that these are the sectional remains of columns. Dr. Ralph Peterson, the marine archaeologist on board, believes that they're looking at millstones, which may date to the Roman age much later than any possible Atlantis. It all depends on what's in the center of the discs. Are the holes square, as in columns, or round, as in millstones?
Now, the thing is, with column drums, they're generally thicker, and they would cut a square in the bottom of it, put in a wooden tenon, okay, and then mount the other one on top of that, and that's how they would build their columns. The reason why is they were square is so that they wouldn't rotate over time.
But the question is that a round hole or is that a square hole?
It might be square, it might not.
They're almost one on top of the other.
The fact that these are one on top of each other doesn't necessarily mean it's architectural. I mean, it could be a ship's cargo. When you put things on a ship, you're stacking them up, particularly if they're flat. And as the ship settles to the bottom, you're going to have still things remaining in their stacked positions.
This doesn't look round at all. This looks like it's a square.
Maybe. I'll give you a maybe on that one.
For the divers, maybe is good enough. After days of coming up empty, they finally have found ancient objects that once, maybe, adorned Atlantis.
They were much bigger than what I anticipated. A meter and a half across, maybe. Really solid, sort of like this thickness. It's definitely not modern times. You know, you can say that for sure. In the true sense of exploration, we had a find. And it was completely, completely by chance.
Georgios agrees with Freund that what they found are columns. He believes that they once adorned a temple. The stones remind him of underwater video footage filmed nearby that has been in his possession for years.
It's really not clear.
It's not clear. It's an old video, but if you focus on it...
Oh, wow.
Something
This looks like a huge structure over here.
Yeah, sure.
Are these steps?
Oh, my God, this is very clear. This is a staircase.
It's clear that this is not natural. This is something that was man-made.
Who shot this?
Este vídeo lo filmó en 1993 Francisco Salazar, que era un maestro buzo que le llamaban el Pantera.
This guy was a legend here.
Una leyenda, uno de los maestros buzos más importantes de Cali.
Is he alive?
No, he's not alive.
Murió en 1998.
It's very bad quality, but it's very clear. It looks like a bunch of broken, huge stones from a megalithic structure.
And you have a wall just in front of it.
A wall, and it looks like a, this is crazy.
A wall. Circular wall.
Circular wall.
Yeah, that's right.
You know, it looks like a tower.
You know what it looks like? It looks like a Nuragi.
It's incredible.
Where is this?
El dato que le dio el Pantera es que estaba entre Barbate y Zahara de los Atunes a menos 35 metros de profundidad.
Is there any way to try to locate that site?
Well, yes, I think so. We know where we have to search.
We gotta find this. We just gotta find it.
We now head to where Georgios believes we'll find Pantera's dive site. It's a patch of water, barely 5 miles long, only 10 miles from where we found the underwater discs. Armed with a 3D sonar, we're all optimistic that a discovery will soon be made. To my surprise, we're smack dab in the middle of a drug trafficking zone, and we're now diving under the watchful eye the Spanish Navy. The Atlantic Explorer scours the search area, going back and forth, creating a well-defined map of the ocean floor. While we wait to identify a specific target, I decide to call James Cameron to update him on the latest developments.
Hey, Jim.
What's up, buddy?
Where are you guys right now?
Southern Spain.
Going outside the pillars of Hercules now.
That's right. It's been going pretty good. The first site we identified, they found this debris field. It could be pieces of columns, or maybe they're millstones. And then there's a new thing that came up, okay? This legendary diver in these parts that they nicknamed the Panther, El Pantera. And El Pantera shot this video footage on VHS, I think. When I got images of it at the beginning, I thought this is a joke, there's nothing. But when I watched still frame grabs, it looks like an underwater Nuragi, like one of these Sardinia type. Like, it's big, it's got pillars, it's got
steps,
it's got circles. It's the Hollywood version of Atlantis, and it's supposed to be right here where we are.
Do you have good coordinates on it?
It's 35 meters deep between Barbate and Zahara de los Atunas.
This is a very sandy area. If you had like a submerged temple fully exposed, it would stand out to sonar. We'll go up and down the grid and we'll find Atlantis.
This sounds too good to be true. I'm not gonna be up all night, you know, hoping on this, but let's see what happens. I think you got to play out the lead for sure. All right, guys, great. I wish I was there on the ship with you right now.
In the meantime, Pantera's coordinates are not panning out. They see an anomaly, something rising from the bottom. Could this be the structure found by Pantera?
This is it. This is all fish.
This is all fish, and the fish can be in a structure. We have a sandy bottom, and then suddenly like a smaller structure, you know? And then a lot of fish.
All right, I'll go tell the divers.
Jump from the side, no?
Like hold down.
Okay.
Fantastic.
I can barely see anything.
It's just the vis is not very good.
Floating just above them, I'm in radio contact with the divers.
What's happening now, guys? What's happening now?
The water is very murky.
Practically blinded, they follow the anchor line down to the bottom. Amazingly, the anchor leads them right on target.
Wow, this is amazing.
What are you seeing?
There are huge boulders down here.
They just seem odd.
Are these the megalithic stones from Pantera's video?
I can't tell if these are man-made.
The divers disperse and find scattered rocks.
These might be discs that have been overgrown with algae.
From certain angles, they seem man-made, but it's hard to tell.
Can you look around in the context, the archaeological context? Can you see any wreckage, anything?
Es muy extraño que sean de forma natural porque están desperdigadas por encima de la arena. Y en concreto yo he visto una forma casi perfectamente semicircular.
I think this is great.
Current is undoubtedly picking up and the swell and the surge makes this dive quite challenging.
They need to surface.
Definitely more interesting. Lots of rocks in quite an almost an unnatural shape, but of course your imagination starts to kind of help a little bit. And I'd really like to get some feedback from Ralph, because you know when your 40 meters down and your mind wants you to find something of interest, it's very easy to start to imagine things. So it'd be good to have a cold analytical view on what we found. The current is going down. So I think the arrow beat could go on. Down.
In an attempt to get answers, Bill and the operators navigate the ROV to the dive site and analyze the incoming images.
Visibility is about a meter and a half.
So whether they're man-made or geological, we don't really know.
That's a big structure, whatever that is.
Wow. Oh.
They call Ralph, the marine archaeologist, for further analysis.
What is it?
After several hours, Ralph can't come to a conclusion. The degradation process on the rocks has taken its toll. He can't determine if they're natural or man-made. If this was once Pantera's temple, only an underwater excavation can establish that now. The divers continue the search, but no alternative site presents itself.
Time starts running out on this expedition. It's a pretty tense situation. If we don't find something here, then we're gonna have to just change to another location.
Reports on harsh weather forced the captain to return to shore. We must temporarily abandon the search. Not realizing that our luck is about to change. The Atlantic Explorer is moored in port, waiting for the sea to calm down. The crew uses this opportunity for inventory and maintenance. I'm thinking, if southern Spain is the original home of Atlantis, and Sardinia was an Atlantean colony, why is there no archaeology here that matches the archaeology there? Georgios thinks he's identified the missing link, a recently excavated 4,000-year-old Sardinian-style temple.
This is in the middle of nowhere, and it was in the middle of nowhere in the Bronze Age, too. There's no cities around here, and they did find Bronze Age burials. We're talking about 1800 BCE. And look over here, a moat.
surrounded by water, concentric circles.
Built 700 years before the nuraghes of Sardinia, I'm astounded to see so many features of Sardinian culture in this Spanish temple.
It's like a maze.
You come up to this place, it doesn't look like much. It's a mini version of what we saw in Sardinia. But look how complex it is. And you can see the themes, the moat, the concentric circles. You can't say this is a metaphor. This is Atlantean architecture as described by Plato. You have the compass points, and in the middle, right over here, you have a deep, deep well. Can it be that some kind of water divinity is being worshipped? Poseidon. And look where it's situated. Once again, we see the same theme described by Plato. It's in the middle of a fertile plateau. This is not a city, it's not a house, it's not a castle. It's a temple, it's a place where people worship. Wow. Being here, I feel like I'm inside a clockwork. This is so precise. Look at the way the ramps lead you around. Look at the ramps of these towers. It's literally breathtaking, and it's all the more breathtaking because it's unexpected. It looks like this tiny little structure. It just looked like a mound until it was excavated some 30 years ago. And it's very hard to date these things, but monks get buried in their monasteries. And right over here, archaeologists discovered and left in situ an ancient burial.
So is this ground zero for an Atlantean culture that later spread all the way to Sardinia? Did Pantera find a temple like this one underwater? I get word that the weather has cleared up. But on the way back, Georgios has one more archaeological ace up his sleeve. High in the mountains, next to engraved concentric Stone Age circles, Georgios has a particular image that he wants me to see.
Sinha, ¿qué ves aquí?
I can't believe it. I see the biblical menorah.
¿Una menorah? Círculos concéntricos, menorah.
You're saying the biblical menorah that was in the temple in Jerusalem that's in the book of Exodus is an evolution of the Atlantean symbol of the concentric circles.
Estoy convencido.
The menorah is somehow memorializing a symbol that meant something for thousands of years.
Del símbolo de la ciudad de Atlantis, la mitad justo es la menorah.
Suddenly, I remember images of the menorah that I saw in 1600-year-old Jewish burials in Malta. They looked exactly like Georgios' symbol, complete with a central pole that was shaped like Poseidon's trident.
This is kind of mind-blowing because you're saying that there's an echo of Atlantean theology in the Bible itself.
Correcto, Sinha.
According to Georgios, it's from shrines like this one that Atlantean refugees spread their symbols to the rest of the world. Back on the boat, we're ready to resume diving.
The Doña Ana Park is ground zero. I think this is where the original ancient mother city port island of Atlantis was located. The question is, what do you do next?
Clearly, we have a problem. If the port of Atlantis is buried deep beneath the mudflats of Doña Ana, then it's simply inaccessible to us. But I have an idea. In Laja Alta, there were two squares depicted on the cave wall. If the square with the concentric circles depicts the port of Atlantis, and maybe the square with the ship represents something else. Some kind of holding area or anchorage out at sea, where ships waited for entry into the fabled port. If such a holding area existed, then the most logical place for it would be near the closest island to the Strait of Gibraltar, Santi Petri. I share my hunch with the team. It's a long shot, but we have no other leads. So we make our way to the target area.
I see something. It's pretty straight.
Que se ve una secuencia de bloques que parece como si fuera un espigón, un muelle.
And this area here could be a holding area.
Yo espero que vamos a encontrar evidencias arqueológicas incuestionables de la existencia de una civilización muy antigua que solo podría relacionarse con la Atlántida.
Captain José María positions the ship. Tensions run high.
Good to go.
What do we look for? Ships? Wood rots over thousands of years, but breakwaters, jetties, and stone anchors don't.
Are these docks?
Maybe they're breakwaters.
And then, finally, a huge ancient stone anchor. Even Ralph, the ever skeptical marine archaeologist, is excited.
It's about this big. It's 83 centimeters across, and it's about this thick. It's smooth on both sides, got a nice hole in it, and we were quite surprised to see that.
After weeks of fruitless searching, everyone's excited when Ralph determines that the anchor could date to the Bronze Age. It fits the Atlantis timeline.
These are stills, yeah.
It's really an amazing find. I mean, a lot of people will get excited about anchors, but this anchor you should get very excited about. This is a 3,000, 4,000-year-old anchor that is massive for a very, very large boat that shows us that ancient large boats were sailing into this area 4,000 years ago.
It's widely believed that mankind did not sail into the Atlantic Ocean before the 8th century BC. According to this idea, all fishing and trading routes in this area were confined to the Mediterranean Sea. This anchor tells a different story.
We're on the Atlantic side. Who's seen stone anchors on this side of the ocean?
It's just a place that hasn't been explored. So here we are, we're doing this stuff for the first time, really. We're finding stuff.
We're pushing the envelope.
We are pushing the envelope.
I wasn't, you know, very confident about these dive sites, but now I feel that the hope is going on.
But a single stone anchor could be just an anomaly, evidence of an ancient boat that went off course. We need more artifacts to support the idea that there once was a great holding area here.
Can you hear me?
Oh.
What trouble are you having?
Current is serious. I wouldn't even just refer to current, but a huge swell is beating us on the bottom. This current is so strong due to the flatness of the site. Oh! Oh, this is something. That's a great one. Incredible. I've never seen anything like that.
What are you seeing?
They just found a square anchor, which is incredible. It's undoubtedly handmade. It has a hole in the middle about the size of a fist.
That's what we were looking for.
Yeah.
Well, I'll tell you guys,
it's something unbelievable. I'm moving very close to another anchor. Undoubtedly, for this area, it's an incredible finding. Certainly, it's not a common object, not even in the Mediterranean, and we are in the Atlantic.
That's absolutely awesome. That's unbelievable.
What a find, what a catch. Miguel is leading us with his reel, but it undoubtedly is struggling very much. It's definitely very serious current.
How many anchors do you see?
I'm approaching now the third one, which has an oval shape. In its maximum extension, it's probably 70, 75 or 80 centimeters long. It looks really in perfect shape.
This could be 3,500 years old, could be 4,000 years old, and it establishes a harbor right here where, you know, I didn't even dare dream to find anchors because it's easier to find a needle in a haystack than third Bronze Age anchors in the Atlantic.
This means something. We are on the right track.
We've now discovered a total of four Bronze Age anchors on the Atlantean side of Spain. But our divers are not finished. An hour later, they find a fifth triangle-shaped anchor.
That's amazing. I really mean it. That's amazing.
And shortly after, anchor number six.
I felt it. I felt good today.
I told you we would be here.
You guys are awesome.
I tell you. I'm so proud to be here.
You guys are making history.
The implications of this find are mind-boggling. Our team found evidence of a holding area exactly where we predicted it would be.
Was it great?
That was great, Simca.
Yeah?
I really feel that we have done something serious. Thanks, mate. That was very good.
Es impresionante. Yo tenía referencias, pero lo habéis encontrado. Ha sido muy emocionante, muy emocionante. Este es el momento más importante de mi vida.
If the anchorage of Atlantis was out here, then maybe, just as Professor Freund theorizes, Atlantis is waiting to be found beneath the mudflats of Doña Ana. And if the stone anchors witness to large ships, how far into the Atlantic Ocean could they have gone? Can we find evidence of their travels halfway to America? Our team has found more Bronze Age anchors on the Atlantic side of Spain than anyone before. If we found six in a few dives, there must be thousands out there, confirming Plato's report of a port just past the Pillars of Hercules. Plato also states that the ships of Atlantis sailed across the Atlantic, stopping at isolated islands en route. To test this claim, we once again go west, all the way to the Azores, Portuguese islands located in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean. 3,500 years before Columbus, could Bronze Age sailors have made it here, almost a third of the way to America? It's a far-fetched idea. When Portuguese explorers first came to the Azores some 500 years ago, they claimed that these islands had never been inhabited. But recently, Professor Felix Rodriguez from the University of the Azores has made some incredible discoveries.
I can't believe what we're looking at. This shouldn't be here, right? Theoretically.
Right.
What is it?
Probably a columbarium, at least Roman.
The Romans used it for burial. They'd cremate the body, they'd put urns, and they'd put it in this columbarium.
Yes, as a burial place, because we have a oven there.
There's an oven there?
Yes, and could explain this structure and give some sense to this.
I'm in shock because it establishes a culture here in very, very ancient times. Right, like way before anybody thought there was anybody here.
This is true. This is amazing. Ancient people comes to the center of the Atlantic.
Remarkably, people here had customs similar to those practiced in the Mediterranean. They lived on these Atlantic islands 2,000 years ago, perhaps earlier. Professor Rodriguez has evidence that can push that date to the Bronze Age, or even before, to the time of Atlantis. Scattered across the cornfields of the Azores are massive pyramid-like structures. These ancient buildings seem to have been connected to each other by an elaborate network of tunnels, which are now partially ruined or blocked.
I'm standing in a cornfield on Pico Island in the Azores, halfway between Europe and the Americas. Behind me, you can see an entrance to an ancient structure that academics have dubbed Neolithic. That's Stone Age. We're talking about thousands of years ago when really no one should have been able to get here. Now, that is connected somehow to this pyramid right next door. And the pyramid, it looks like an ancient ziggurat. It's like the biblical Tower of Babel, maybe something Aztec almost looking. People don't know because really no one has studied it. Anybody looking at that can see that there's a pyramid over there and some kind of ancient entrance blocked up.
An archaeological treasure that hasn't been fully excavated.
This is a fantastic structure made by dry stones.
By dry stones, you mean no cement?
No cement. This is well-planned, and we need a huge amount of dry stone to build this building. A partial excavation was made inside the chamber, and it was found stone tools. Ancient stone tools. That means this could be from the Stone Age. This is very weird for the Azores possession. We need knowledge and lots of people to build this.
This is amazing. Again, Stone Age technology. We're talking 4,000, 5,000, 6,000 years old. The same technology that we've seen from the Eastern Mediterranean all the way to the Azores. Giant boulders stacked up on each other, holding for thousands of years without cement. And this time we're not in the Mediterranean. It's part of some kind of civilization that reached all the way to the Atlantic.
And there's even more evidence of ancient inhabitants on the island. I trek with Professor Rodriguez through a thick forest to see a Stone Age village which contains megalithic structures very similar to those I saw on Malta, 2,200 miles away.
Very slippery, guys, super slippery.
Professor Rodriguez discovered this place in 2014. Based on the stone tools found here, he believes the village may be 6,000 years old, and yet it's virtually unknown to the academic world. Professor Rodriguez has even discovered a man-made cave in this ancient settlement.
This is incredible. This, out of the megalithic structures that we've seen, this is the most sophisticated one. Maybe it was someone's home, maybe, you know, the chief, but maybe it was some kind of holy place. We may be in an early, early shrine. There's an outer section to it and an inner chamber, which is kind of the inner holy of holies, is a shrine.
Outside the forest, Professor Rodriguez shows me an artifact that is totally out of place on this modern farm. It's a piece of archaeology which can radically redefine our understanding of Stone Age seafaring.
What is that?
It's a Stone Age anchor.
This is amazing to find it here. What's it doing inside a fence?
It's used it as a stone, a normal stone.
The farmer was just collecting?
Yes, collecting from here and put in the wall.
I gotta tell you, I can show you stuff like this that we discovered underwater in southern Spain. In fact, this is much bigger than what we shot because we found ones kind of elliptical, half that size, with one hole. This has two holes. It must have been a giant boat.
This is something huge.
If there's an anchor here and there's a Stone Age village, it must have been near the harbor, near the water.
We have two water lines, one in this side of the hill, little river that goes straight to the sea.
You're rewriting the history of human travel in the Stone Age.
This could help to describe the ancient people movements between different spaces in the world.
Professor Rodriguez now shows me another incredible discovery.
This is amazing. These are cartrots.
Yes, this is cartrots, clearly cartrots. Similar to those one of Malta, comes from nowhere and goes to somewhere in the sea. In the middle of the island, we'll have lots of cartrots.
All over the islands?
All the islands, except the smallest one.
And they haven't really been studied?
None. None of them.
When do you think these cartrots date to?
From the first millennium BC.
Third millennium BC. Wow. You know, when we started this journey, cartrots didn't mean anything to me. But then when you see this technology, sophisticated technology, mysterious technology, on all these islands, Malta, Sardinia, Sicily, now the Azores, we're talking about Stone Age people getting to all these places, creating this technology and using it for a long time. Nobody knows why or how. It's amazing. But one thing it does do, it actually puts people on this island and shows that people could get here by boat more than 4,000 years ago, 6,000 years ago maybe.
It now seems clear to me that even before the pyramids in Egypt, there existed a Stone Age and Bronze Age civilization, an ancient, long-forgotten empire. Its center seems to have been in southern Spain, exactly where Plato puts Atlantis. I now believe that this civilization shared a common culture, architecture, and great seafaring capability as Plato's Atlantis. This empire was most probably destroyed in a series of Santorini-related natural disasters. It seems that Plato's Atlantis is no mere myth.
Hey, Jim, we did it.
You did it. You found great stuff. You found the anchors. You proved that there's a trading culture out in the Atlantic beyond the Pillars of Hercules. This is fantastic evidence.
But did you locate Atlantis? Well, maybe.
You know, Atlantis could be buried under the mud at Tartessos. We need to investigate that further. I'm saying
prove it.
Find it. Dig it up.